Good morning, church. Hopefully you're having a fantastic Sunday. If you want to find your way to your seats, I'm going to give a couple announcements and then we're going to start worship. So next Sunday is the Sunrise Social, 9 a.m. coffee, pastries, fellowship. You're going to find it down by the coffee cart, correct? Okay, that's where I thought. Second thing, if you are interested in being an usher, you can find all that information at the welcome booth. Sign up, get that information. And the third thing is prime time dinner and game night. $5. Again, all that information is going to be at the Welcome Center. All right, guys, if you want to stand up and join us in worship.
It's a song of the redeemed, rising from the African plains. It's a song of the forgiven, drowning at the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe and every tongue, every nation, a love song born of the grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns.
See, let it rise.
Let it rise above the four winds, caught up in a heavenly sound. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, yes, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none ring truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns.
Then all the powers of darkness tremble at what they just heard. 'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they just heard. 'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. And all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. Just sing that to him. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, and hallelujah, he reigns. Father, we're so excited to be here. We love you so much, Father. We thank you that you are the most important person in the room. And we love you and we thank you. Amen. Well, guys, good morning. Thanks for coming to Valley Live today. And can we take a couple minutes? Let's just take a couple minutes to greet one another. I see some new faces today. Let's greet one another, then we'll get started in just a few minutes, guys. Father, we thank you so much for your incredible love. Father, we thank you that we love you because you first love us. Father, and on our darkest day, you didn't lose sight of who we were. So we thank you for that. We thank you, Father. Holy Spirit, we thank you for what you're doing in this place. Father, when people come here, we want them to experience you and your great love. Your incredible grace that empowers us to change, we thank you. We thank you, Father. Amen. Amen. It's going to be a good time. Amen. So let our praise be your welcome. Let our songs be a sign. We are here for you. We are here for you. Let your breath come from heaven and fill our hearts with your life. 'Cause we are here. To you our hearts are open. and nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down. So let our shine. From your heart. So let our praise be your welcome, and let our songs, let them be a sign, cause we are here for you. Yeah, we are here for you. When all I see is a battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you.
Oh, can we just sing that again? When all I see.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory.
Yeah, come on.
When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you.
So when I fight, I will fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. And oh God, the battle belongs to you. Ain't every fear I lay at your feet, God, I sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the the power of our God. And in almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. And you shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
Yeah.
Man, the Lord just keeps bringing back the part of the song where it says, you shine in the shadows and you win every battle. And I don't know who needs to hear it, but you need to know that our God hasn't lost a single battle. Every battle he wages, he wins every single time. So I'm asking you today, if you think you're losing a battle, change your perspective and see what heaven sees, because I see God winning the battle. Can I get an amen? That's exciting. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. And you shine in the shadows, and you win every battle. Nothing can stand against
the
one more time.
Power of our God.
An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. And you shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. And I see your face, and I see your face in every sunrise, and the colors of the morning are inside your eyes. The world awakens in the light of the day. I look up to the sky and say, you're beautiful. See your face.
And I see your face in every sunrise. The colors of the morn are inside your eyes. The world awakens in the light of the day. And I look up to the sky and say, you're beautiful. Beautiful.
see you there, hanging on a tree. You bled and then you died and then you rose again for me. And now you're sitting on your heavenly throne. Soon we will be coming home. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. Come on, sing with me, love. When we arrive at eternity's shore, and death is just a memory, and tears are no more, and we'll enter in as the wedding bells ring, and your bride will come together, and we'll sing, you're beautiful, you're beautiful, you're beautiful, you're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. Just sing. You're beautiful.
Father, I'm just so thankful for that day. When we arrive there, your bride, holy, blameless, without blemish. Father, I thank you just for the incredible bride in this room. Jesus, you're so beautiful. You are so beautiful. Our God's amazing and he loves us so much. I want to take some time to pray because our God's amazing, and it's not that prayer works, it's that he loves us. And can I have our intercessors, deacons? Josh, come on. And we don't just worship a God in the sky who doesn't care about us. He loves us and he cares about us. And he actually cares about every single thing about us. Every little thing we face, he cares for us. And so I want to give this opportunity for people. Like if you have sickness, if you're in a battle, if you feel like you're walking through the valley of shadow of death and you have fear, you need to come up here and get some prayer. And the elders of the church will anoint you with oil. So I'm just gonna continue the song, but please, like this is, we can go through every single person here and I can give you a testimony of God working wonders in their life. But for God to work those wonders, you have to say yes. You got to say yes. So this is no pressure, but I'm just going to play. And if you want prayer, please come forward, and we want to pray for you.
And I see your face in every sunrise. The colors of the morning are inside your eyes. The world awakens in the light of the day. I look up to the sky and say, you're beautiful.
Guys, we're not rushing this at all. And if you can't stand, raise your hand and we'll come over to you, okay?
And I see you there hanging on a tree. You bled and then you died, and then you rose again for me. Now you are sitting on your heavenly throne. Soon we will be coming home. So beautiful. So beautiful. So beautiful. God who was and is to come, the power of the risen one, the God who brings the dead to life, the God of miracles.
to give it a couple, just a few more moments here. I actually heard God tell me that I was going to end it, and he said, no, I'm still waiting for someone. And I want you to know that God loves you so much, he's not moving. That's how much he loves you. So no pressure, but God loves you. The God who was and is to come, the power of the risen one, the God who brings the dead to life, you're the God of miracles. Yes, we believe in you, the God of Yeah, can we all just clap for what God's doing in the room right now? Just give him thanks. Thank you, Father, for what you're doing. You're so amazing. Thank you.
Good morning. I just want to remind us again that next Sunday We're going to have the opportunity to take the love offering to remind our pastors how much we appreciate them. And again, you know, we talked about different ways to show appreciation. You can send cards, things like that. So just a reminder, I don't know about you, but sometimes you're in church on Sunday and somebody says something and you think, yeah, and you go home and something happens and the next thing you know, it's next Sunday and you think, wow, where'd that go? So just a little reminder there. And then to do the offering today, you know, I don't know if you're all getting the opportunity to read through the Bible with Pastor, but this last week he's had us in Exodus. And God was giving instructions to Moses about the tabernacle. And what he said in Exodus 25, verses 1 and 2, he said to Moses, tell the people to bring me an offering. You are to receive the offering for me from each man whose heart is willing to give. And you know, those people, God invites us into his work. Those people were being invited into building the tabernacle. That's what we're invited to with our offering, is to build the church. And then the church has the opportunity to reach out and extend its hand in many different ways to others around the world and to others in our community and then in our own body. So it's with that willing heart that we continue to come to the offering in a worshipful attitude. And you know, those people gave so much, they finally had to tell them to stop. Isn't that something, that if we would give so much, somebody would have to say stop? So anyway, but we have the opportunity to love on God, to love on the church, to love on one another by giving our tithes and offerings. If the ushers would please come forward. Father, we give thanks to you that we can show our love to you and to one another and to our church family, Father, and the community by bringing our tithes and offerings. Thank you that you invited us into your work, God, and that we can freely give as you have freely given to us. So, Father, I just pray a blessing over your people. I pray a desire over your people to give, to freely give as you have freely given to us, not only financially, but in so many other ways. And I just thank you, God, for an opportunity to join you in the work that you have called us to join you in this day and in every day. We give you praise and honor, God, in your holy name. Amen. Brandon Riley, understand that you had something you were going to share. Where'd you go? Ah, here you come.
So I was asked to just kind of give a testimony of how God has provided for us and my family. It's about 3 years ago we moved to Oregon. Didn't really know why. When people asked, we just said, I don't know. I think it all comes down to willingness to follow. We don't think we knew it at the time, but we were meant to be here. We were moving to Dallas for a reason. We didn't know it. We bought a house for his plan, and we didn't know. That house essentially tried to kill us. We're still fighting a lawsuit after a year and a half of living outside the home. Through the darkest time in our life, God showed us light. Yeah. the fire, you find faith. I don't want to live my life fearing the fire. I think we all have the strength to stand faithfully in the fire because that's where we actually meet Jesus. If you look up the definition of a crucible, it's essentially to put contents into a hot fire that changes them from what they were to something new. We all have crucibles to face, and it's not a bad thing. We were talking about Daniel chapter 3 earlier this week. When they refused to worship any other god, they were thrown into the fire bound. And you know the story, they came out not even smelling of smoke. The only thing that fire burned was what bound them. We shouldn't fear the fire. He's with us in that fire. So whatever weapons the enemy raised against us ended up delivering us into our Father's arms. And we have peace and we have joy. I never thought I'd find happiness being homeless. That's how he works. Sometimes, you know, we follow, and where he leads us is something better than we could have ever imagined. It takes trust, and true strength comes from the source, and you get there through surrender. That's how change takes place. That's how you find a new heart. You find the value he put in you in the beginning. We have to lay down our own lives and get out of our own way and realize how good he is. I heard earlier this week, beauty is not hard to find. It's just easy to overlook. So if the enemy turned our life into a pile of rubble, I'm going to climb on top of it and declare how good he is. We're all meant to glow in the dark, so don't fear it. Praise him.
All right, niños and niñas, time to go to class, okay? Go ahead, guys. The kids are dismissed to go to children's church. Really quickly, I always say this. I'm going to say it again. I just love this sound. Just hearing them run. God is so good, yes? I don't know about you, man, but worship was amazing. That testimony was outstanding. I'm just expecting God to do great and powerful things. Are you guys with me? Oh, yes. Let's get right into it, yeah? Okay. My name is Pastor John. If you guys didn't know me, I'm the youth pastor here. It is my privilege to be in this church to see what God is doing within our town. Really quickly, who went to the Glow Run really quickly? Who went to the Glow Run? Only two people? Four? Okay, awesome. Okay, good. Was it fun? It was so much fun, right? Okay, for my adults, who did the foam? Who went under the bubbles? Yes? Okay, awesome. Okay. Another thing is this, too. Be on the lookout for a scarecrow that will have a Valued Life t-shirt and you and Jesus Loves You sign on there. I think we're spot number 6, I think. Be out there if you guys want to. Is this cheating? I'm not sure. But vote for that one, okay? All right? I think it is cheating. Isn't that cheating? I'm not sure. But whatever, vote for it. I don't care. Okay, all right. So My message tonight, or tonight, this morning, excuse me, is darkness into light. And so if you're taking down notes, taking down that kind of stuff, I want to say this one thing. You've retained about 70% more when you write stuff down than when you hear it, okay? So do me a favor, take down notes, take down some scripture, and if you don't know what the title is, it's right behind me right there, okay? And so before we continue, before we go, let me pray. I pray, Lord Jesus, may you have this message, may you have this time. I pray, Father God, may you have this these people. You already know who's here. You already know who's online. And I pray, Lord Jesus, they're here not on accident, but Father God, you have orchestrated them to be this very second right here, right now, online and in this room. In name we pray, amen, amen, amen. What month are we in? Anybody know? What month are we in? October. Good job. Okay. All right. And so what happens in October? Anybody know? Okay. Halloween. What else? Birthday. Okay. Whose birthday is that? Woo! Okay. All right. Awesome. Okay. And so with that, it comes out, what, pumpkin spice, right? Okay. For some reason, some ladies dressed like Han Solo with the high boots and the black vest and the white shirt, okay, right? Another thing is this, once again, Halloween, right? And all for my teenagers in here, okay, and young kids, what do you get during those times? Candy, okay? Who loves candy? Awesome, okay? I had to, refrain myself as a youth pastor. I wanted to throw out candy, and I figured that'd be kind of distracting. And I'll hit somebody in the face with it. I don't want to do that, okay? But one of the things about this season, I remember growing up, we went trick-or-treating, okay? And I thought I was super, super brave, okay? Super brave, okay? Big old guy, right? Super brave. And for some reason, I don't know, no idea, we were trick-or-treating, and we live in not, just a lower-end neighborhood, and us kids knew what neighborhoods to hit up for full-size candy bars, right? And we just stood there and went back and forth, and our couple, just got a ton of candy. And I remember just walking around thinking all big and bad with my friends. And I'm not going to stand up here and lie to you. This is 100% true, okay? 100% true. I have no idea why I got scared, right? But I was walking, and literally this little girl, okay, in a princess outfit, okay, like this small, right? And I was just talking, and she hit the corner, and for some reason I got so scared, I screamed, right? And all my friends were like, "Bro, what's up? What's wrong with you?" It's like, nothing, just a small little girl. That's it, right? And so, to that day, I still have some nightmares. No, I'm just kidding. Okay. Really quickly before we continue, I'm gonna give you guys just a forewarning. Is that okay? During this message, at one point, we're going to close those double doors back there, okay? And this whole room is going to get really pitch black, okay? All right? Just give you guys a forewarning for that. All right? So a lot of us can relate to being scared, yes? Who's ever been scared, okay? All right? It's really terrifying when you have young kids who are sneaky like a mouse, okay? This morning, my little son, Seth, he's so small. And sometimes I can't hear him sometimes. Like, I'll be talking to Whitney, and, he'll be standing right there, just right there. I have no idea he's there. And he's like, "Daddy." I'm like, "Oh, my goodness, stop," right? "I'm going to put a bell on you," kind of thing, right? We all can relate to being scared, right? We all can relate to having a phobia of some kind, right? And if we're being honest, if we're being 100% real, we fear something, right? And maybe your fear is like you're afraid of spiders. You're afraid of little girls in princess outfits, okay? I don't know what it is, right? But I one time read a survey about teenagers, okay? A survey about teenagers. And here is what they said they fear, okay? Let me give a dramatic pause real fast. 51% of teenagers said this. They were afraid of talking to their parents about personal problems. 40% said they were afraid of not fitting in at school. 75% said they were afraid of not getting good grades. 66% said they were afraid of the future and life after graduating. Church, there's a lot of phobias out there, okay, right? And a lot of them are kind of silly. A lot of them are kind of like, yeah, that's, you should be terrified of that. Like, who is afraid of sharks? I am, okay, right? But the one thing I want to touch on this very Sunday is this, is that the fear of darkness, the fear of darkness. And I'm sure a lot of us can relate that we're at one point at adolescence or even in our adulthood afraid of the dark at some point, right? And how about the idea of being left in the dark or missing out on something? If we're honest, we have some level of FOMO, okay? FOMO, what's that mean, right? Okay, what is that? We're talking about a youth pastor, okay? The definition is this, is the anxiety of that an exciting event may be occurring and may be happening elsewhere. Let's think about this idea, church, about darkness for a second. Really quickly, I love audience participation. Can people repeat after me? Dark. Let's do it one more time. Dark. Can you do a really, really deep voice and say dark? Yeah, dark. Okay, all right? When the Bible talks about darkness, okay, it almost always talks about light along with it, okay? And today's verses is in the Bible, in the latter part of the Bible, in the New Testament. So if you have your Bible app, open up to John chapter 1. John chapter 1. If you're there, give me amen if you're there. Okay, good. Verses 5 and 6 says this. This is the message we heard from Jesus. Now it declares to you, God is light, and there is no darkness in him at all. So we are lying if we say we have fellowship with God, but go on living in spiritual darkness. We are not practicing the truth, but if we are living in the light, as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other. The blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we claim we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, to cleanse us from all wickedness. There's something to be said right here. There's something to be looking at right here. If we can just truly understand what the scripture is saying, I believe, church, it will drastically change you from the inside out. It will open your eyes to what God is saying to you. It will transform you on how you look at life and how you live life. The one thing that every person on this planet has a strong desire is this, is that who is God? Who is God? I don't care if you're an atheist. I don't care if you're agnostic. I don't care where you're at right now. Everyone has that one question. Who is God? Who is this God? What is this God? Kind of thing. In this first verse, we read this. And this message, we hear that Jesus is now declares to you is this, that God is light. God is absolute light. Everyone say light. Good, thank you so much. You guys are so good. I want to look at this one word, light, okay? Light. When it comes to light, what comes to mind, okay? When it comes to mind, you might think of the sun. You might think of a flashlight. You might think of a lighthouse. You might think of a glow stick, right? Well, for me, this is what I think of light, okay? This is what comes to my mind when I think of this stuff, right? Is that you ever had a problem or an answer you're thinking about or trying to solve, right? Okay? And you're like, you're trying to figure it out. So you're trying to think of the answer. And all of a sudden, right, it just pops in your head. You're like, the light bulb just turned on, okay, right? And you have what? You have the answer, okay? Whenever someone is thinking hard and the answer finally comes to them, right, people say this, that the light has finally turned on, okay? And so we have this light bulb, right? And this light bulb represents the answer, and the light represents God, so God is the answer. But what's the question? What's the question, church? You see, we spend our lives looking and searching for answers. We go to Google and we ask for answers. We go to the elders and ask for answers. We search and we search and we search. Who is God? Who is he? What is he? Why is he? But here it is. He is the ultimate answer. He is the ultimate search engine. He is the ultimate book you ever find in your life. He is the answer. You want to know the answer to your life questions? Go to him. You want to know the answer to your life's questions? Read the word and go to him. If you have questions, then why is my teenager feeling going through this? Ask and come to God. If you ask questions, why is my finances in trouble? Go to God. Why is my relationship with my spouse kind of shaky? Go to God. No matter where you're at to this very morning, go to him. Go to him first. Before you go to Google, go to him. But I have this question for you. This question I wrestled with my own self when I was first saved. When I was first saved. And once I understood this, church, it helped me live a life seeking him. It helped me live a life that sought after him. It helped me live a life that to give up my old life and run to him when I'm asking this question. Because growing up, I was literally Bible illiterate. I didn't know nothing about Genesis, nothing about Revelation. Didn't know nothing at all. And this pastor said this phrase, and really kind of like, what does that mean? What is spiritual darkness? Spiritual darkness. Let's look back at 1 John, okay? It says this, we are lying if we have fellowship with God, but go on living in a spiritual darkness. We are not practicing the truth. What is spiritual darkness? We already said this, church, that God is light, and light is the answer to your problem. Light is the answer to your shortcoming. Light is the answer to the overcoming. Light is the answer to where you don't feel any strength, you go to the light. So darkness must be the problem we need to answer to. We need an answer to that. Why we have this? I asked you this question, what came to your mind as to this about light, but I want to ask you the same question. What comes to your mind when you think of darkness? You see, it would not take you long to move past the regular things, the obvious things of a dark night. A cloudy sky. Move past a dark room. To some, this is the dark things in your life. The dark things in your life. The things you're going through. The obstacle that seems so big and so overwhelming that it almost like has cast a shadow over you. The dark things. You see, there are so many angry, negative, painful, destructive things that we do in the dark. Things that we are warned not to do by God. But let me give you an example. Let's consider this. The stuff that you look on the internet, right, in the dark when no one is around. You see, in those moments that you're terrified of your loved one finding out, or your parents checking your phone, or anyone else finding out. It could be where you go on to some type of social media accounts, or the thoughts that you have in your head when no one knows about. Let me stop there real fast. The thoughts in your head of people. Don't raise your hand, please. I want you to do it. But who's ever gossiped about somebody? Who's ever said negative things about somebody? We can get so easy to get in the trap in that. So easy to talk about the gossip. Talk about other people behind their back. Or this. Maybe the way you spend your money. As much like what Billy Graham has said, give me 5 minutes with someone's checkbook and I'll show you where their heart really is. Or this, the anger that's inside you. Maybe for my women in here and my men in here, maybe you struggle with anger. It is so easy for you to get angry that quickly. Why is that? Why do you get so angry so quickly? Church, let me say this. Can you hear me out? You are not alone in this. Let me say it one more time. You are not alone in this. You see, being up here, right? Being up here sometimes on Sundays, mostly on Wednesdays, I get to tell stories. And Can I be transparent? I'm a very transparent person, okay? I want to make it seem like I have it all together, okay? But I don't. I don't have it all together. The truth is this, that none of the leaders here have it all together. The truth is this, none of the board members have it all together. Don't do elbows, but the person next to you doesn't have it all together, okay? We all struggle. Hear my friend. We all struggle, okay? We all struggle with spiritual darkness. And the Bible calls this dark thing sin, okay? And the Bible says all sin leads to death. All sin leads to death. Either leads to a physical death or a spiritual death, okay? All sin leads to death. No one is excluded. If they think they are, they're only tricking themselves. People struggle with not participating in sin. We don't want to do it. When we're angry, right? The Bible says it's okay to get angry, right? It's okay to be angry, but not act out in anger, okay? We struggle with that sometimes. We struggle with the words we say sometimes. We struggle. We struggle to not sometimes think bad about somebody. We sometimes struggle with this. The truth is, we all struggle with it and with spiritual darkness. But you know what else is true? Hear me out. You know what else is true? Darkness sucks. Okay? Hear me say it one more time. Darkness sucks. It really, really stinks. Okay? Who's you ever got up in the middle of the night? Who's ever got up in the middle of the night? Everyone here, obviously. Okay? All right? You got up in the middle of the night, right? And you had to go to the potty, right? And you're just like, oh, I'm just going to wake up and go to the bathroom. That seems really simple, yes? Right? Okay? And then all of a sudden, you're walking, right? And then you stub your toe, right? On a chair. You stub your toe on your bed kind of thing, right? And you just stub it. And I believe, hear me out, I believe stubbing your toe in the middle of the night is more painful than stepping on a Lego. I'm going to say it one more time, okay? All right? It is more painful. Darkness, it messes with you, okay? And darkness, you can sometimes hurt yourself. It confuses you. Like, why did I just stub my toe? I just wanted to go to the bathroom. It seemed really simple. I'm an adult man. I can get up and go to the bathroom outside my toe. I guess I cannot, right? Okay? But man, it messes with you. It confuses you. And you're like, oh my goodness, why is this happening? But God is light. He is the answer to the darkness. He is the answer to any problem you face. He is the answer to any shortcoming you face. He is the answer to your life questions. He is the answer to why you stub your toe. Maybe you need to move your chair, right? Okay, kind of thing. But he is the answer. You see, in 1 John 1:7, it says this, but if we are living in light, as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Listen to this truth. We need to realize we are in darkness. We need to choose to step into light. One more time. We need to realize we are in darkness. We need to choose to step into the light. You need to choose to step into the light. You need to choose to do that stuff. Make that choice to step into where God is at. Step into where he's at. See, coming into the light can be painful. It's much like this, right? Man, you are walking in dark kind of thing, right? You just stub your toe. You're confused. You're kind of crying a little bit. Your wife is kind of snickering in the background. You hear her, right, kind of thing. And you're just like, oh, my goodness. And then you're just confused. And then you turn the light on. What happens? It kind of hurts because your eyes are just adjusting, like, oh, my goodness, kind of thing. Now you're blind, right? Your toe hurts. And now your pride is hurt because your wife is laughing at you kind of thing, okay? But it can be painful at some points. But when we step out in the darkness and step into it, put the darkness behind us, when you realize that God is the only true source of life, only true source of light in your life, you can go to him. You can be surrounded by him. My friend, hear me right now. Maybe you're in darkness of some sort. Maybe you're struggling with some kind of sin. struggling with some kind of anger, struggling with some kind of addiction, struggling with something in your life. You see, I've been doing youth ministry for about 16 years, okay? I've been doing youth ministry for about 16 years. And the one thing I know to be true about a teenager is this, is that when a teenager chooses to make God their priority in their life, they can absolutely change the world. Absolutely change the world. How you figured? Did you guys know that the disciples, okay, were not full-grown men with beards, okay? Maybe one had a beard, I'm not sure. They were not full-grown men. They were young teenagers. Young teenagers. Let me stop right there. Can we give you guys a little bit of biblical background, okay? All right? Who's ever heard of the scripture, your words like honey upon my lips, okay, kind of thing, right? Really quickly, back then, there was two things that you wanted to do. The first one is this, is become a rabbi, become a teacher, okay? That's the one thing, that's your main priority. They will raise you up, right, to learn the Old Testament, word for word. And one of the ways they would teach a young student on scripture is that they would put honey on the tablets and make him memorize it with like that. And so here it is too. At the end of this whole thing, the teachers, the rabbis, would come up to these students. We would line them up like this. Line them up. And they're asking these really, really hard questions. Ask them to quote this scripture. And if they were not good enough, they would go to their father's trade. A father's trade could be a carpenter. A father's trade could be a fisherman. A father's trade could be something in that sense. It's absolutely mind-boggling when you hear this, and this would make so much sense of why they did this, is that when the rabbi said, "You're good enough, this is what I'm looking for," he would say this to you, "Come follow me. Come follow me." Can you imagine, if you will, your first dream in your life was to be this rabbi, to be this teacher, to say, am I good enough? Am I truly good enough? And then they say, you're not good, go to your father's trade. But then a rabbi came up to you and said, come follow me. You are good enough. You see, sometimes we're in darkness. Sometimes we feel like we're shortcomings. Sometimes we feel like we're not good enough, that we'll never be good enough. Man, look at the messes that I made, the things I've said within my heart and out loud. I'm not good enough. I'm not good enough. And the whole time, church, God is saying, you are good enough. Come follow me. Come follow me. Come out of the lights. Come into the light. Come out of the darkness. Come out of the darkness. Come into the light. He says, you are good enough. He said, once you realize that God is the only true source of life in your life, no matter what life throws at you, church, no matter what circumstances throws at you, hear me out, teenager. Whatever that person said in recess, the person said during lunch period, no matter what your father or mother said to you long ago, no matter what mistakes you have made to this very point in time right now, God is saying this, you are good enough. Come out from the darkness. Come out, come out, come out. You see, it's easy to adjust to the dark. It's easy to adjust to the dark when it happens slowly, right? It happens over time. We get used to darkness. We get used to that stuff in our life. It starts with something simple, right? We begin to just feel like this is just the way of life. This is just the way things are. This is the way it's always going to be. It just keeps getting darker and darker and darker and darker. But by the time you notice and realize that what's happening to you, you lost sight of any hope. You lost sight of who God is. You became comfortable. You became saying to yourself, but I don't really need God because I have this. Look what I accomplished. I really don't need him right now. Maybe later, but not right now. It reminds me of this movie, of this quote. And when I say it, you'll probably remember it. But it says this, that sometimes the devil allows people to live a life free of trouble because he doesn't want them turning to God. Their sin is like a jail cell, except it's all nice, comfy, and there's doesn't seem to be any reason to live. The door is wide open until one day time runs out and the cell door slams shut, and suddenly it's too late. I was just like that, my friend. I felt so comfortable in my sin. I felt so comfortable who I was, what I accomplished. I felt like I didn't need nobody except myself. Until God opened my eyes to what he did for me. He opened my eyes and said, even though you did this, even though you said that, the actions, the words you said, I died for you. And it might feel like you have freedom. It might feel like you're in light. But right now, you're just used to the darkness. You're just used to it. It feels like you're free, but you're not. You're encaged. You're trapped. You're surrounded. And God is saying this to you. Come out of the light. Come to me. Come to me. I'm going to have the band come up real fast. I'm going to have the whole band come up. Just instruments and then maybe Jesse, please. Instruments and Jesse. Pastor Jesse. Reverend Jesse. Man of the cloth, Jesse. Okay, all right? Okay. Let me say this real fast. Don't wait. Do not wait until the door slams shut. Teenager, let me see your watch of your eyes. Don't wait until the door is slammed shut. Don't wait. You see, sometimes, not just teenagers, not just young adults, but even adults itself, we can sometimes be in this pridefulness, right? Sometimes we can have our arms crossed, either physically or emotionally, and say, I don't need that. I don't need that. I'll wait. I'll wait. I'll wait until I'm ready, 100% ready to give my life to Jesus. I'll wait. My friend, we're not, I've heard that for so many years. I'll wait, I'll wait, I'll wait. The one thing I know to be true is don't wait. Do not wait. Give your life to Jesus. Because tomorrow, this afternoon, this night is not promise. It's not. You know, from my background, okay, I had many, many access to a lot of people. And one of my friends, his name was Johnny. His name was Johnny. And me and this guy would do life together in such a wrong way. And I remember one time I was a Christian at that point. And I went to my friend and said this. And I don't say this story to stir up emotions, to make you feel pressure. I'm just giving you an example. I had a friend that we were doing things like my background. And my friend was in darkness. And I would tell my friend who Jesus was. I would tell my friend that he saved my life. I would told my friend this, that I've seen teenagers, and I would not lie to you because that is, I don't want to give a false testimony at all. I would told my friend that I've seen teenagers on a mission field where a lady got shot in the back, became paralyzed, And I've seen teenagers lay hands on this woman. And she literally stood up and started walking. You might think to yourself, oh, yeah, right, Johnny. Yeah, okay, okay.
Okay.
Kind of thing, right? But literally, we're in the projects of New York. Everyone knew this lady. Everyone knew this lady. When everyone turned and saw her walking, it was just, the whole park erupted. I was telling my friend another story of how I took kids on a mission field. And we're all walking. I told these teenagers this. Expect God to do something in your life. If you have been baptized by the Holy Spirit with evidence in speaking in tongues, I want you to start speaking that now. Because I believe this is the moment where God wants us to do something. And we're all walking. And all of a sudden, who's ever been to Mexico? Anybody ever been to Mexico? Okay. All right. For my Latins, the motherland. Okay. Kind of thing. Okay. And we went there, and usually in Mexico, it's like really hot, right? Okay. Sometimes it can be a little cold, but sometimes it's really hot. And we're all walking, and for some reason, it got overcast, and it got chilly. And we're walking and stuff. And all of a sudden, we're walking, and then this guy started coming down to us. I'm telling my friend this. This guy said, "Are you guys missionaries?" I was like, "No, we're not missionaries. We're on mission trips. It's still the same, okay, kind of thing." And he says, "Hey, can you pray for my son? He's not really my son, but I was on a mission field, and this lady just gave me her son, and her son from infancy was a vegetable. You guys know what that means, okay?" For my junior hires, he was not an actual vegetable, okay, right? He couldn't move, he couldn't talk for himself, except breathe, that's it, okay? So can you pray for my son? Can you pray for him? I was like, yeah, I'll pray. My student said, yeah, we'll pray. And I said, guys, this is the moment. This is the very, 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 very moment. And then we start praying for this boy. Start laying hands on this boy, and my teenagers. All of a sudden, got really hot in that room. And this kid, who was literally a vegetable, started moving. He shot up and started talking. I remember at the end of the thing, we had him come in, right? I think I shared this story before, I'm not sure. But we had them come in, right? We had like 400 Mexicans at the outreach, okay, right? And so my people are so transparent, they're so real, I love it so much, okay? And then when they saw, they knew who this kid was, okay? This kid walked on stage, and it's so funny, I can still hear the noise, right? Like 400 Mexicans were like, ay, great kind of thing, okay? They were so like, oh my goodness, right? It's like, ooh, okay, kind of thing. And I told him this, like, and it was so amazing. The place erupted. I told my friend that's like, this is what God has done in my life. This is what God has done in teenagers' life. I was like, Johnny, hear me out, man. Go to him. You see, I wish I can tell you that he gave his life to Jesus that day. He didn't. I remember sitting in my room on the TV and stuff, and I put on the news. I never put on the news, and they said this: there was a police chase that happened. This kid named Johnny got he died on spot. He tried to evade police, and he died on spots. You see, the word of God can change anybody, but it's a free gift. Where's Alan at? You see Alan? Who's Alan? Where's Alan at? You see Alan? Can someone just close those double doors back there? Anybody? Any random person? Thank you. Seth, anybody? Okay. As they close those doors, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to give you an example. Sometimes people are in darkness. I'm going to give you a quick example, an illustrated to what I'm saying right now. Remember what I said. All these lights in here are going to go black. Okay? So really quickly, turn off all the lights. Every single light. Completely dark. We are going to experience this darkness together. You see, sometimes we're in darkness, and sometimes we can't see, sometimes it's confusing, and sometimes we feel like, where is God in this? And I told you this one thing. All you have to do, church, is go to Him, go to His Word. Go to the very thing that will illuminate your life. Because the one thing that can do it is God. The one thing that can illuminate your life is the Bible. It's much like this book right here. It seems like an ordinary book. But when you open it up, you see that it illuminates your life. When you open it up, it sees like, I need Jesus. When you open it up, it says, I need God. When you open it up, it says, I know I messed up. Lord, I know I messed up. Lord, I know I have sinned in my life. Lord, I know I'm in darkness. But Lord, it feels like it's just who I am. But God, I need you more than ever now. God, it's just your word that brings me life. God, is your word that saved a gang member like me. God, is your word that saved me for myself. And maybe here into this very moment, right now, this very second, you are in this darkness. But all you have to do, my friend, is open up the very word of God to illuminate your life. Just go to Him. Go to Him. Go to Him. Don't wait. Don't wait. Put the lights back on. Don't wait. Don't wait. Don't wait. I'm going to stop here. I know we're running a little late, but let me stop here because I don't want you to miss this moment. I don't want you to miss this moment, this very second. You see, I'm a firm believer, teenager. I'm a firm believer. You're not here on accident. You're not here just because your parents drug you here. Okay? You're here for a purpose. You're not a mistake. Hear me out right now, young adults. You're here this very second, this very moment to hear this very message because the Holy Spirit has been talking to you, and He's been talking to you, and this is just a confirmation of what God wants to do in your life. I'm not trying to tug at your emotional strings. What I'm trying to do is open your eyes to what God wants for you. He says this, to come out of the darkness and come into the light. Come to Him. Go to Him. So really quick, I'm going to have the board members just come up here, right here, or a few intercessors just come up here, right here, and give you a few seconds, a few moments. Just come up here, guys. Come on. Come on, guys. Come on. Okay? I'm actually going to have I'm going to have Joshua come up here as well, too. I'm going to have him stand right here kind of thing. Okay? Trying to find where she's at. Where is she? I can't find her. Oh my goodness. Okay. It's important. Okay. This is so good. Okay. All right. So hear me out. There's two types of people in this room. Now, this is called an altar call right here, okay? It's called an altar call. There's two types of people that are going to respond to this message tonight, or this morning, is that you for those who have not stepped into the light. When you realize, you never realized that you were in the darkness. And you're going to make this choice tonight, this very morning, to step out into the light and accept Jesus to be your Lord and Savior. To accept Jesus to be your Lord and Savior. The second person is this, to those that have stepped into the light before, but you're not walking in the light right now. You have a divided life. You have one foot in light and one foot in darkness. You play church. You play it. But you're saying this very morning, no more. I am done living a life that is torn between light and darkness. I want to live fully in the light. I believe there's two types of people who are going to do that today. Who's ever heard this? Whoever heard this phrase, hear me out. And we're almost done. I promise you guys. You guys are doing so good. Thank you so much. Who's ever heard this phrase? If one person, right, comes to Jesus, all of heaven, all of the angels rejoices. Who's ever heard of that? Okay, right? Let me give you guys what that scripture is actually mentioning. Okay, hear me out. We hear that, and we think that's what it means. And actually, what that scripture is actually referencing is this. Okay? Where's Jesus? The right side of God, right? Did you know this? That actually Jesus, in that scripture we're referencing, is that actually Jesus stands up from his seat. And he rejoices over you. He rejoices. And he says, I know her. I know him. He's my family. She's my family. I know them. So I'm going to give you guys this moment. Everyone just bow your heads and close your eyes. There's nothing symbolic about this. What this creates is just a between you and Jesus moment. And some of you, I'm going to ask something of you that I don't think we ever done this before. I'm not sure. I'm going to ask you this. If you want to accept Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, one of these people up here are going to pray with you. And you're thinking to yourself, oh man, Pastor John, that's kind of scary. That's kind of frightening. Hear me out. It is scary. But stepping out and saying, oh, the darkness can't be scary. But stepping into the light is that much better. Even this, how about this? If you were a Christian at one point, you went back to your old living. It's called backsliding. If you want to make a recommitment to Jesus this very morning, if you want to do that tonight, or I keep saying tonight, this very morning, I want you to come forward. They're going to pray with you. They're going to pray with you. So I'm going to give you guys a few moments. If that's you, I want you to stand up. Don't think twice. I want you to stand up and go to these people. They're going to pray with you for salvation. They're going to pray with you for recommitment. So if that's you, I'm going to give you a few moments. A few moments. It's a few moments.
I'm waiting for you, God, and I won't move until I hear you speak. I'll fall down on my knees. I'm desperate for you, God.
Everyone look up real fast. There's three people in here right now. There's three people, two girls and one boy. Two girls and one I'm sorry, not boy, a man. Two boys, oh my goodness, blech. Two girls and one man. One girl has a blonde hair. This man has no hair. And the third one is a teenager. I know for a fact there's three right now in this room. A man with no hair. a person with blonde hair and a teenager. I know you're in here. Where are you at? I know you're in here. So don't, please, hear me out. Hear me. Look at me. Look at me right here, right on my nose. Look at me. Look at me. This is your moment. I'm just going to say it. Who gives a rip about what your neighbor thinks? Who cares, right? Who cares? Because it's not you and them in Jesus. It's you and Jesus. So if that's you, I know for a fact there's three of you in here. I know for a fact there's three of you in here. Matter of fact, the two are like right here. The two are right here, and the one is right here. One's right here. So once again, I'm going to give you guys a few more moments. And hear me, I know it's scary. Because what do they think of me? Who cares? Well, what if they, who cares? But what if, who cares? It's between you and God. So I'm going to give you guys a moment. Just everyone just close your eyes once again. There's three in here. I know for a fact there's three in here. If that's you, I want you to stand up right now. Stand up with me. Stand up. If that's you, stand up. If that's you, stand up. If that's you, stand up. Don't wait. Come out of the darkness. If that's you, stand up. There's two more people. If that's you, stand up. Don't wait. Come on. Don't let the pride set in. Don't let the what ifs set in. If that's you, stand up. Come on, church. I know there's two more in you. There's two more. There's absolutely two more. Come on. I know for a fact. I know it. I want you to, my friend, I want you to step, come back down, and I want you to pray. Pray with Miss Pat right here, okay? We're going to pray for you, pray for salvation, pray for whoever that is. And there's two more people. Come on. Let God do God, right? Okay? Come on, church. Sometimes it can be kind of scary. Sometimes it can be kind of worrisome. But God is so good. He is so good. He is absolutely so good. If that's you, stand up. I'm going to give you a few more moments. A few more moments. If that's you, stand up. Jesus. Okay. Everyone look at me real fast. Look at me real quickly. For my two people who didn't stand up, I want you to meet me after service. I want you to meet me after service. I'm going to pray with you. I'm going to be there with you. I'm going to be with you. And know this, you're not alone. You're not alone. Matter of fact, let me give some comfort. No one's perfect. No one's perfect. And if you're looking for a perfect church, and you stepped in that perfect church, you made it imperfect, okay? So, it's only who Christ is in us that we ask for him to make us perfect. So if that's you, if you want to make a recommitment to your life, or this, or you want to make Jesus your Lord and Savior your life, come see me after service, and I will pray with you, okay? Jesus, I pray, Father God, thank you so much for what you're doing in this church. Thank you so much for what you did in this service. And Father God, thank you so much for the patience of, we went a little long, Father God, but thank you so much. Thank you, God. Father God, you can do what only you can do. Father God, we love you. We honor you, Father God. We uplift you. And Father God, for that teenager and that man with no hair, Father God, may they be bold enough to come to me and I can pray with them, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray, amen, amen, amen. Hey guys, thank you so much for your time. Thank you so much for what God is doing in your life. Hey guys, I see you guys this week coming up. Go enjoy some lunch.